Good morning. I said good morning. Are you ready to praise the Lord today? Everybody get on your feet today. We're here to lift up the Lord Jesus and exalt him today in this place. We've already had a phenomenal 9 o'clock service. You're in for a treat. Let's lift our voice and bless the Lord today. Father, thank you for your presence here. Be glorified throughout our time together as we lift praise to your holy name. We praise you today. You alone are worthy of glory and honor. God, fill this house with your presence. Thank you that you're here waiting for us to worship you and bless you today. We right now give you the praise for what you're going to do in Jesus' holy name. And let everybody shout a good amen. Come on, let's give Ricardo Sanchez a great warm welcome to Life Source International Church today.
Sing it with me, say, our God is great. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, oh, our God.
Somebody shout hallelujah. Travis, can I get more vocal in my monitor?
Water you turned, say, water you turned into wine. You opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you.
To the darkness you shine. Oh, 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 oh.
Into the darkness you shine.
And out of the ashes we rise.
Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one.
Spirit and
our
God is greater. Our God is greater. Say,
our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer.
Yes, He is. Sing it again. Our God is greater. Our God is greater.
Our God is greater.
To my darkness you shine, oh.
Into the darkness you shine.
And out of the ashes we rise.
Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you.
We receive it, Jesus, and
what could love Jesus this morning? If you love God, somebody lift your hands, lift your voice, and shout hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the promise of your presence in our praise and in our worship. And Father, though we all might have come from different days, some of us different cultures, things aren't lined up exactly like the Ravens are lined up for next week. Father, some of us need you. We long for your presence. Father, this morning is not about a man. It's not about a book or a ministry. This morning is all about you. So church, just lift your hands and just for a few moments, just begin to open your mouth and tell him that you love him. Tell him that you need him. You long for his presence. Love you, Jesus. You are Alpha and Omega, and we worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. You are Alpha, you are Alpha.
Yeah.
in majesty. Sing it. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He rides. He rides.
Jesus, Jesus.
riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign.
In 2006, I was flying to Australia to be a part of a conference. And I was worship leading for a guy named Jensen Franklin in Gainesville, Georgia. So Pastor Franklin and I were on this airplane, and he said, "Ricardo, I really want you to pay attention to the Spirit of God on this trip. Because I'm not looking for a style of music. I simply want the anointing in the music." Because how many of you know our sermons, our songs, our giftings never helped nobody? Our songs never saved nobody. It's the anointing in the song. It's the anointing in the sermon. It's in the anointing in the gifting. And as I sat in Acer Arena, I was bombarded with the presence of God. Somebody say bombarded. It was so engulfing, and it just so surrounded me that genres and styles and preferences seemed to just fly out the window. And what grasped me was the anointing. And when we got on an airplane headed back to Gainesville, Georgia, I pulled out a napkin and I pulled out a pen and I wrote these words. I wrote, "I'm not going back. I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you my past is over in you. All things are made new. Surrender my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward." Is anybody moving forward this morning? What a moment, sing it with me, say, what a moment. You have brought me to such a freedom. I have found in you, you're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not going south.
Sing it again, forward.
put my hand to the plow, not look back and forward. Come on, say.
Say, I'm letting it go. Letting it go. I'm not going to let anything hold me down. Nothing hold me back. Not going to let people hold me back. Not going to let unforgiveness hold me back. Not going to let hindrances, past failures, mistakes, defeats. I'm not going to let it hold me down. I'm moving forward in the name of Jesus. I'm moving forward. God has me moving ahead. This is a season of acceleration in the Spirit. I'm moving ahead. I'm moving forward. I'm going where God wants me to go. I'm tired of going my own way and doing my own thing and being confined by people's comments and thoughts and what their expectations are. I'm going to move forward. I'm going to go ahead where God wants to take me. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are in the forward momentum of God right now. And you need to have the mindset you're not going to let anything keep you from going where God wants to take you. You're in it right now. You're in the slingshot. You're in the catapult. You're in that place of getting the momentum right now to move forward. Shake it all off. Shake that stuff off. God has you in a place. He's getting ready to let go. He's getting ready to let loose. He's getting ready to take you forward. Hallelujah. Come on, shake it off. Shake it loose today. Shake it loose today. Oh, yes. Mighty God, mighty God. Hallelujah. Listen. This just isn't, this isn't an emotional thing. Sure, it feels good to feel good. Sure, it's wonderful to shout and praise God. But when you can capture what God's doing in your mind and settle it in your heart and understand what God is doing in your midst, in your life today, there is an anointing on Ricardo's praise and worship that has a prophetic unction to it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's announcing. It's announcing what God's doing. It's announcing what God's plan is in your life. It's announcing what is yet to come in your life. You have to capture that. Say, yes, God, that's for me. Hallelujah. 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 And listen, there's such a heavy anointing in this place. God may have it targeted for someone else, but you can be like that Syrophoenician woman who said, listen, I'm going to get some for myself. It's for everybody. She went to Jesus and said, I need healing for my daughter. And he said, no, healing is for children's bread. She said, I just want some of the crumbs. Listen, what was meant for somebody else, you can get a hold of for yourself today and say, it's for me, it's for my family, it's for my life, it's for my marriage. Come on, somebody say, I got it. Somebody say, I got it. Hallelujah. Woo, yeah. You capture it today when he's singing, when the praise and worship is going forth, you get lost in hearing what God is saying through that word. Man, that's for me. That's my marriage. That's my family. That's my kids. That's my business. That's my health. That's my finances. That's my relationship. That's where I am going. When he's declaring it, you declare it right with him. Amen? Hallelujah. Everybody lift your hands all over this building. Just tell the Lord you love him today. Just worship him for a minute. For where he's brought you from. You wouldn't be where you are today if he hadn't been alongside of you. Carrying you sometimes along the way. Moving mountains out of the way. Obstacles that could have taken you out and put you down and kept you under. But you're here today. You're in this place because of the goodness of God. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We worship you this morning. You're so good to us. You've been so good. We just want to stop and say, Lord, we love you. We're not asking you for anything right now. We're just children at your feet saying, we love you, Daddy. We love you, Father. We love you, God. We worship you, Jesus, this morning. Hallelujah. You see, it's when you begin to worship and begin to magnify the Lord, you realize he's been better to you than you deserve. He's been better to me than I deserve, that's for sure. Lord, I just love you today. I worship you. I glorify you, Lord. Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Now, I want you to capture this word that was just sung, and that's just sung in that song. It said, you make all things new. Come on, begin to pronounce a newness over your life. Begin to pronounce a newness in your circumstance and in your marriage today. You make all things new, and I'm going to follow you, Lord. All things new, all things new. Make it new, Lord, make it new. Hallelujah. Yes, you do. Somebody's going to get newness today. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord.
Make it new, make it new. Take out the old, make it new, Lord. Yes, 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 yes. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, you're going to receive the newness that God has for you today. Lift up praise to Him right now. Come on, give God praise in this place today. He's worthy. Amen. God has a new for you today. Did you hear what I said? God has a new for you. You believe that? Oh, God is at work. How many of you feel the Spirit of God moving today in this place? Amen. It's time for Kid Life. Our children, grades 1 through 5, headed to the Family Life Center next door. Take just a few moments, turn to the person behind you, in front of you. Greet them and welcome them to Life Source International Church today. God bless you. God for His presence. So glad that you have decided to be in the house of God today. I think you made a good choice. I think you made a good decision today. And by the time you leave here, you're going to know you did for certain if you don't know already. We want to welcome you. So glad that you're here. If you're a first-time guest, second time, maybe you've just recently come, whether it's by invitation or you just drove by and said, you know what, I need to check that place out, we're glad that you're here. So very glad. We'd ask you this morning, if you take a moment, reach for a guest card. It's located in the pew rack in front of you. Take a moment and fill it out. And after you filled it out, when you exit the sanctuary, in the lobby, we have a guest table with gift bags that we've prepared for you. Just a simple token of our appreciation for you being with us today. And we pray God's richest blessings on you and your life. And we pray that, again, you would come and worship God in this place. God meets with us every Sunday, and for that, we're grateful. I want you to give our Life Source International Church guests a wonderful, warm welcome. Would you do that today? Amen. We're so glad that you've come. This past week in the one-year Bible, there's a passage of Scripture in Exodus chapter 3, verse number 18. It's when the people of Israel are going to get delivered out of Egyptian bondage, and Moses goes before Pharaoh. He says something very interesting to Pharaoh that I think we should take note of today. He says these words in verse 18 of chapter 3. He says, "The Lord God has met with us."
Therefore, let us go into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to him. And the principle is really, really simple, and it is this. When God really meets with you, giving is not a problem. As a matter of fact, the presence of God will prompt you to give. When God's presence is near, it will prompt you to give him praise. It'll prompt you to give him worship. It'll prompt you to offer him something. And there are different ways to do that. Moses said, we have to go into the wilderness and give him a sacrifice. Now, I want you to listen to this. They were, by the world standards, poor. Are you hearing me? Don't ever focus on what you don't have. If you focus on what you don't have and what isn't and what's not there, you'll never get to where you need to get to in God. You need to focus on what you have to give. We've had some strange things in the offerings at times. You know why? Because I've told people over the years, when you're absolutely flat broke, give him something. Learn to be a giver. See, people get so focused on the amount of stuff that they miss the whole principle of giving. So I've told people, I've said, look, I'm going to give you an illustration right here. See this shirt that I'm wearing right now? At the bottom of everybody's shirt, usually, there's an extra button there. I got an extra button right here on my shirt. These things bug me sometimes, but if I ever pop one, I'm glad I've got one there. And with the physique your pastor has, sometimes I get the flexing and they just bust all over the place. So those kinds of things come in handy. You know what I'm talking about? But I've told people, I said, look, if you don't have a dime, if you don't have a buck, if you don't rip the button off of your shirt and give it. If you got a pen in your pocket, learn to give. Because if you'll learn to give this when you don't have this, it won't be long before you have this and this. But you've got to learn to be a giver with what you have first. Those poor Hebrews said, we got to go in the wilderness and sacrifice to God. Church, learn to give. That is a gateway to heaven. I'm telling you right now, God will bless and increase you. As we worship God in giving today, there are two envelopes in your pew. One has an LS. That's for the Life Source logo. That's for our local ministry here, your tithe and offering. Then there's another envelope in your pew. It's called Earth Ablaze. The Earth Ablaze envelope is for our worldwide ministry, and we are presently focused on Kenya in Africa. I was up very, very early this morning and I called our brothers and sisters in Nairobi, capital of Kenya, and they had just finished service there in our mother church that we've planted there that's just 3 weeks old. And the truck that you bought and purchased and fitted with a sound system is out on the streets today, spreading the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's because of your faithful giving. So over the phone, I had them lay hands on that truck. And we prayed and committed it to God, to the glory of God. Those wheels are rolling. We're going to carry benevolence all over Kenya and into other parts of Africa. That truck is going to be busy day and night in street meetings during the day, in crusade meetings at night, carrying police officers. Brother Ricardo, the police officers are doing the evangelism on the streets of Kenya. We witnessed it. We were out there with them. As a matter of fact, we're planting churches there. Every one of our pastors is a police officer in the Kenya military. okay, in the police force and in their military. I mean, these are people that are sold out to God, and they're doing a phenomenal work. So that's the earth ablaze for worldwide ministry. Today, as you worship God in giving, God will take note of your giving, and He will reward you. But that's not the reason you do it, is it? You know, when I first got saved, for those of you that don't know, you know how I got saved? That beautiful woman right there, I saw her in high school. I had never been to church in my life, and I wanted to date her, and she wouldn't date me and said, unless you come to church, I'll go out with you if you come to church. She threw out, you know, got me hook, line, and sinker. Well, for that beautiful woman, I'd go anywhere. Church is a no-brainer for me. So I went to church, okay? And she started telling me about the second coming of Jesus. I had never heard it before in my life. Started talking to me about hell. I knew I didn't want to go there because that sounded like a really bad place. I was a heathen, man. I knew nothing about God. But listen to me. That can kind of motivate you to want to go to heaven when you hear about hell. I don't even think about hell now. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I don't even think about hell. I just love God and I want to serve Him with all my heart. It's the same with giving. I don't think about the reward. I don't think about God blessing me. I give because I love Him, because He deserves my best. Amen. Hold your gifts in your hand today. Father, I pray heaven's blessing upon your people today. Open the windows of heaven over them. God, may you meet every need of their lives. But Lord, let the motivation for giving not be to get, but because we love you. Because we love you supremely. You deserve our best. We thank you for blessing your people today and receiving our gifts in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. As you worship in giving, there are containers on the top step on this level here. Two of them, same over here. The very back of these three aisles, there are desks with giving receptacles. Also at the balcony main exits, there are desks with giving receptacles. Those of you watching the webcast, there's an online giving button. Many people use that every week. May the Lord bless you. Give your ear to Ricardo as he continues to lead us today.
Do you love the Lord, church? Any good to be in the house of God this morning? I got to tell you, your pastors are so cool. Come on, give them a round of applause. It's we've never really met, and they're just treating us like kings, man. I'm like, honey, I think you need to come here. I don't bring the boys. You need to hang out here in Baltimore. It's a little cold outside, too, by the way. I've been married to my girlfriend for 15 years. And yeah, absolutely, ladies. Husbands, you need to clap too because they're sitting next to you. And we have three sons, Ricardo, Josiah, and Micah. And I miss my boys right now. Somebody asked me one time, Ricardo, what's it like being away from the family? And I said, it's horrible. But you know, when you're called to something, and I liken it to a missionary, who is going to a third world country who may or may not have the water that they're used to drinking, or the smells are a little bit different. They prepare for the food to taste a little bit different, language to be a little more difficult. And it's the same way as a traveling musician or a traveling minister. Things aren't always the way they should be. And in 2011, on June 9th, it was one of those days which was one of the worst days of my life. I was landing in Jacksonville Airport to do the Global Day of Prayer with a bunch of different artists whom you may or may not know. And our label was sponsoring it, and so they flew us out there. And as my plane was landing, I always get my phone out as soon as we land, and I pop it on, and immediately, my phone was bombarded with 911 emergency texts. I said, get home. It was from my pastor, from my best friends. But the one I returned the phone call to was to Jeanette, my wife. And she was hysterical on the other line. And you have to understand my wife. She's a rock. She grew up in a Christian home. She knows the Bible inside and out. And she loves God with a passion. She's friends to sinners. She shows people Jesus. She's not ashamed of the gospel. And this strong rock couldn't even speak. As I was desperate to try to understand what chaos had erupted in Atlanta with my family, I finally got out of her. They took him. They're air vacuuming him to Scottish Rite Hospital. I'm like, baby, what's going on? She said, Josiah, our middle son, dove into his friend's pool head first. Dove in the shallow end. And he broke his C3, C4, C5, and C6 vertebrae. And the paramedics took him and said, prepare your heart for the worst. In my 9 years of being a firefighter, we've never seen a child survive something like this. He said he's got a 1% chance to live. And church, all I'm doing is minding God's business. I'm not in some sin. I'm doing what God told me to do. And I'm on an airplane with people I don't even know. I don't understand who they are. And I get this news. And I'm numb. I don't know what to say. I'm in doubt. I'm like, what are you talking about? I just remember getting my guitar and getting my gig bag and stumbling off this airplane. Terminal A, Jacksonville, I'll never forget it all my life. I passed the ticket counter. And as I passed the ticket counter, I fell to my knees. And I fell on my face. And I began to cry out to God. See, I didn't care who heard me. I didn't care who was going to say what. I'm 6'5", weigh 200, none of your business, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I take up a little bit of space. And I was saying, God, don't you remember me? Don't you remember those prophetic words you spoke over my wife's womb? And he's going to be a fireball for you. And he's going to preach your word. Where are you? I'm doing your work, and this is what happens. I wish I could come here and tell you that everything in that moment worked out great. Everybody got saved. I took an offering, and all was good in the land of Ricardo. That's not what happened. I laid on that floor, and I cried out to God, and I didn't care. It's my baby, man. And I realized this. I realized that nothing will knock you to your knees or take your breath away from you anything quicker than that news of a hurting child or a hurting grandchild. I don't care how big and strong you are. It'll knock you down, man. And I remember just crying out to God. Go, why? And all I could see was him in a wheelchair. I feel all this emotion again, you know. It all comes back. That's all I could see. His other two brothers, I could see him playing in the yard. You have to understand, Christopher Reeves, Superman, only had two of his vertebrae broken. My son had his 3, 4, 5, and 6. So that's all I saw. Yeah, I was messed up. I was laying on the floor, crying out to God, singing every blood song I knew, trying to memorize every scripture I could possibly quote and pray and plead over my child. We wrote a song called I Call Your Name. Lord, you reply, you bring your kingdom and stand by my side. Giver of life, more than I need. Father, you're everything that's precious to me. I remember crying out to God and just saying, I call your name, and God, please reply. Please bring your kingdom and stand with Josiah.
had nothing. I was empty. I remember laying on the floor. And a few months before, I had written a song with a friend of mine. And the song suddenly came to my memory. And I started speaking it. The song says, it's not over. It's not finished. It's not ending. It's only the beginning. Because when God is in it, all things are new. And I began to cry this song out, a lot like right here. I knew they thought I was demon-possessed. They thought something, but they left me alone. I thought I'd be arrested. I'm like, bring it on, Jack. And in the vamp of the song, it says, when God is in it, there is no limit. When God is in it, it's not over. There's more to the story. Laid on the floor for over 4 hours. Some of you have been laying on that floor, the proverbial floor, metaphorically speaking, for 4 years. We have a video that we want to show you. You get to meet my wife. She's much prettier than me. And it shares with you the rest of the story. You guys ready with that video? All right, check out the screens real quick.
It was June 9th, and Ricardo and I were actually headed into the airport. I was going with him to the airport to take him to Jacksonville, Florida for the National Day of Prayer. And I got a phone call as we were driving from the friend of one of our sons. He was at their house swimming. And all she said on the other end of the line was, Jeanette, there's been an accident. And I could hear commotion in the background. And she said, your son Josiah dove into the shallow end of a pool. And he's not good.
I'm getting ready for the National Day of Prayer in Jacksonville. And as I call home, you know, Jeanette is distraught, and my wife is a rock. She doesn't get rattled very easy. So when I heard that in her voice, I knew something drastically was wrong. And she went on to tell me that the paramedics just took our son. And air-vacced him to Scottish Rite Hospital. And then she said the words, they're saying the worst. And that's all she could really get out. And I hung up the phone, got on my knees in the terminal, and just started praying, you know? And I literally was laying on the floor. People must have thought I was out of my mind, but I was. I really was. Because I couldn't comprehend or ever conceive something like this happening to one of my sons.
You know, as a mom watching your son take off in a helicopter saying, Mommy, don't leave me, is just heart-wrenching. And so we got to the hospital and still didn't know, and EMTs had ripped his shirt off and they were running all these kind of tests. And we had come to find out later that he had actually broken his C3, C4, C5, and C6. And they were the same ones that actually put Christopher Reeves in a wheelchair. And we still hadn't heard any positive news. Doctors still weren't giving us anything. We had just sent out a text just saying, they are saying the worst. Please pray for our son. We got a phone call out of the blue from a doctor we didn't even know that was a friend of the family and said, I spoke to the emergency room. I want you to know your son is going to be okay. And just that breath of hope of just going, God, you're so good. And hearing those words, your son is going to be okay, was one of those moments that you just exhale a sigh of relief. And you know, Ricardo said it best later when we were reflecting on it all, it almost feels like we had just walked through a gauntlet of grace, and we were so overwhelmed with kindness and love from friends and family and church members. And I'll never forget, there was a gal and her daughter that walked into the hospital one morning, and I saw them and just gave them a hug, just weeping. And she said, Jeanette, I want you to know that both my daughter and I had a dream last night, the same dream. And we woke up and we saw Josiah at the bottom of that pool, and we saw an angel there picking him up, and that angel said, it's not over. And we just knew, as Ricardo had said in sharing this story in this song, that there was a testimony out there for people who maybe feel broken, who feel like it's over, who, you know, don't know where their hope is, that God is faithful and just and gracious, and Josiah is okay, and he's going to walk, and he's doing amazing, and all the doctors have said he's nothing but a complete miracle.
If you may not have a broken neck, but you may have a broken heart, and I'm just here to say that Jesus can fix that, and also that it's not over.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Glory to God.
We made that video because he was embarrassed to go to school with the brace. And being from Atlanta, he hated that it was Pittsburgh Steelers colors. But I told him, Josiah, we're going to make you a video, because the Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And what you walk through is you share the story. God can use it to help somebody. Maybe a little boy or a little girl, maybe a mom or a dad, walk through a season like this. Maybe your words can help. So at the very end of this filming in our basement, Saya was watching. We call him Saya. He was watching everything. He's just in the back, just pacing, you know. And I looked and I said, "Hey, baby, we're about to wrap it up. Do you want to say anything?" He goes, "Yeah." Sat on my mama's lap, and he looked into the camera and he said, "You might not have a broken neck." Unscripted, just came from his spirit. You might not have a broken neck, but you might have a broken heart. And you need to know Jesus can fix that. It's not over. So this morning, I don't know what you're walking through. You might not have a broken neck. You could have a broken marriage. You could have broken finances. The health in your body might not be the way it should be. Your children might not be serving God the way they were raised to serve God. But never forget that when God is in it, there is no limit. When God is in it, it's not over.
It's not over. It's not finished. It's not ending. It's only the beginning. Is in there, all things are new. Ooh, ooh, all things are new. The old has passed away, all things are new. New, all things are new.
Walking through something, listen.
I know it's dark, just before dawn. This might be the hardest season you've experienced. I know it hurts, it won't be too long. You're closer than you think you are, you're closer than you've been before. So look to the sky, help is on the way.
It's not over,
oh, no, no.
It's not finished,
not ending, no.
It's not, not ending,
it's only the beginning. When God is in there, all things are. Behold, all things are new. Oh, all things are new, new, new. Oh, 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 oh. It's not over, no, no. When God is in it, oh.
walking through an it's not over season, I'm going to prophesy this verse over you. Something is moving, turning around. Seasons are changing. Everything is different now. Here comes the sun, piercing the clouds. Oh, you're closer than you think you are. You're closer than you've been before. So look to the sky. Help is on the way. Yeah. Our God is faithful. He's faithful to say it's not over. It's not finished. Oh, it's not ending. It's not ending. Only the beginning.
Only the beginning.
Oh, oh, not over. Not over.
It's not finished. Oh, it's not ending.
Only the beginning.
Only the beginning.
When God,
is in
yes,
there.
He is. Yes, He is. Touch two people and say, you're not over.
You're not over.
over in Jesus' name. You may be seated in the house of God as they bring the pulpit up here. I like that, Darren. That's nice. Would you please join me in giving a round of applause to your praise team? You guys are awesome. Pastor, they're incredible. Everywhere we go, everybody says, oh, Ricardo, you're going to love our team. They're awesome. We get that wherever we go. And sometimes I think, God, were they speaking in faith? But I'm telling you, when we heard your team was awesome, we hear it, we just receive it, and we pray for the best. And I got to tell you, when we got here and heard him sing and heard him play, what they sang and how they sang exceeded our expectation. Give them another round of applause, please. They're awesome. Sound guys, Travis, you guys are awesome. Light guys, you guys are blessed, man. Not everybody has it as good as you do. Just say, just that's how we roll, Ricardo. You know, sorry. Wish you could have caught us on our A day. It's only our B material. Well, I got to tell you, in that season, if it's not over, God has a way of creating muscles. He has a way of ministering to you in that season. Would you please join me? I totally forgot. I got some guys with me. Brother Sean on drums, Brother Howard on keys, Darren on bass, and Kyle on guitar. Give them a round of applause. Thank you, guys. Hallelujah. Now, don't clap too long. They're going to get expensive. Well, Ricardo, we had a two-minute round of applause. I think we need to double our rate. Y'all can double it with Israel Houghton. Go on to Freddie Rodriguez. I'm just kidding. Have you ever noticed that life has a way of throwing you curveballs when you least expect it? If you've lived life long enough, I'm sure you've had a few experiences of your own where you weren't sure how all the pieces were going to fit together, how all the brokenness would make sense. Paul refers to running the race of life in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Verse 24. Listen to the Message translation. The Message translation says the words run to win. But how do you run to win when you feel the very life, the very air has been knocked out of you? How do you go on and do what you're called to do when there's nothing in you? Maybe you're watching your children make decisions that are pushing them further from God. Maybe your spouse has walked out on you. Maybe you've lost your life savings in this faltering economy. Whatever it is, if you've lived life long enough, you've experienced pain. You've experienced those moments where you proclaim in faith it's not over, though everything in the natural may look and feel totally different. One of the areas in our life where we encountered God was in this experience of asking why. Somebody say why. Some people spend their whole life rooted in why. God, why this and why that? People fail to step over the why, what we can call the valley of why. Why do bad things happen? Why do trials and tribulation happen to good people? Why do bad things happen to good people? Have you ever asked that? I found the answer. I found the answer to that question. Why do bad things don't happen to good people? Bad things happen to all people. Listen, we're in the world. Jesus said you're in the world, but you're not of the world. I need to remind some people here this morning that it's not what happens to you that defines you. It's how you respond to what happens to you that will ultimately end up defining who you are. Well, she was raped. She had an abortion. He cheated on her. No more. That's the one who overcame rape. That's the one who overcame abortion and the one who overcame divorce in the name of Jesus. Never forget this as long as you live. The enemy knows your name.
but he calls you by your weakness. But God knows your weakness, yet still calls you by your name. Isn't that beautiful? There was a blind man in the Gospels. His name was Blind Bartimaeus. Everybody called him Blind Bartimaeus. You know the story. He couldn't see, but he heard Jesus. You can sometimes hear him. And as he heard, he was saying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And the Bible says that his friends were telling him, yo, Bartimaeus, be quiet. Don't mess with this cat. Shh. Don't mess with the master. Be quiet. It's like your boss doesn't like you talking about Jesus. Some of your family, shh, just be quiet about Jesus. Ricardo, let's not worship God. Don't, my uncle's here. Don't worship God the way you, don't tell people to lift their hands because my cousins are here. And they don't worship. Let me just help you in your understanding real quick. Your uncle worships, and so does your cousins. They may not worship Jesus. They may have been worshiping Brooks and Dunn the night before at the old country bar. They may have been worshiping Eminem on Friday and Saturday, Beyonce, Jay-Z. Shatta. Somebody just felt the spirit. Oh, they were lifting their hands. They might have had a drink in their hand, but they were lifting their hands. Oh, they were dancing. They weren't dancing to Ricardo music. They should have been dancing to Ricardo music. The world knows how to worship. I said the world knows how to worship. They just ain't worshiping the truth. They ain't worshiping eternity. They're worshiping something that's temporary. You see what I'm saying? Never be ashamed of the gospel. Never be ashamed to lift your hands and open your mouth wherever you are. In fact, this valley of why. Some of us get stuck in this place and we keep asking why. And we're following this 5, 10, 15-year-old memo because we were hurt 5, 10, 15 years ago. And we see ourselves falling into the valley. Y'all see the valley? The why? You see the letter Y? Come on, church. You see the valley? Somebody asked me what I'm looking for. Come on. I'm looking for an amen. Okay, cool. All right. Thought I fell in the Presbyterian joint here. I didn't know. The valley. You could fall into a valley very easily. It takes no muscles. It takes no effort. Some of you have been pushed into this valley. Remember what you used to be? Remember who your father was? You never be nothing. And not just good opportunity, but God opportunity comes by you. But you don't want to be hurt again. And you end up getting rooted in this valley of why. A God relationship comes by. And you know it's from God, but you just don't want to be hurt again. A business opportunity comes by, and you know it's from God, and you're, I don't want to get burnt again. And you find yourself stuck in this valley, living it out for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Some of us are still being controlled by people who are dead and buried some 30 years ago. But those words that they spoke over you still speak to you. And you're still stuck in the place and in the valley of why. And you're filled with the Spirit of God. You have every tool necessary at your arsenal and disposal, yet you're living in low life. There ain't no difference from your marriage than the sinner's marriage across the street. It got awfully quiet here, so I feel like I'm on the neck of something. So I'm just going to keep pressing until I kill that thing. Kill that thing that's been breathing over you the rest of your whole life. Kill that thing that's been teasing you and haunting you your whole ministry. Because you don't need to live like that. Never forget this. Some of us never become great because we're just satisfied with being good. We're content with what we have, so there ain't no reason. I never gonna grow. I'm not the one who has to change. Check this out. If we're to be more like Jesus, are you with me? If we're to be more like Jesus and Jesus never changes, If we're to be more like God and God never changes, guess who has to change? But it hurts when it's our spouse telling us. It hurts when our parents are telling us. Some of us are stuck in a valley of wine. We can't figure out how to get out. To get out of a valley, it takes even different muscles, stronger muscles, different kind of muscles. Would you agree? To climb out of something. This valley of why is where we were at. And I couldn't get out of it. I was on the floor. God, why? Why? And I said that statement that we all say as fathers, as good fathers over our children. God, break my neck. Let him live. Kill me. Take my life. He's a beautiful little baby boy. Why? And as I sat there, it was pondering this why. I'm like, God, how do I get out of the valley of why? How did all this happen? I suddenly saw the arms of the why. Ricardo, you want to know how you get over the valley of why? As you picture those arms of the why. As arms extended in worship, you picture those arms. Because the Bible says that he inhabits those praises of his people. That when he comes, it's not just a part of him that comes. It's not just when pastor prays over us. The very same power that raised Christ from the dead lives and dwells and breathes within each and every believer. I believe that. The anointing of God is in you. You're not worthy. You're not. We're not. I'm not. I'm not worthy. It's only by the blood of Jesus that we have access to the anointing, that we have access to our Father in heaven. It's only through the blood of Jesus. It's not what you've done. It's what he's already accomplished on Calvary's mountain. You just receive it. Have you ever gotten a Christmas gift and never opened it? But that's what so many believers are doing in their life. They're doing in their finances. They're doing in their marriages. Well, I haven't seen the miraculous. Well, have you been sowing? Well, I have, as long as the earth remains, so we'll see time and harvest. No, 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 no. As long as the earth remains, sometimes it's seed time and harvest. As long as the earth remains, it could be seed time and harvest. As long it could be seed time and harvest. For some, it's not seed time and harvest. I believe the access is there. I don't give to receive. I give because God's asked me to give. I don't give to get. I get to give. You hear the double entendre? We don't give to get. We get to give. When you waste time on the wise, you can end up living your entire life in a valley and be stuck and never come out of that valley. But the way that you avoid the valley is through your worship and through your praise. You have to stay in a constant attitude of worship to experience that full John 10:10 life. Those detours, when they don't make sense, God somehow has a way of piecing all those broken things together. If you're in the midst of a situation that seems hopeless and you're not sure why you're going through it, I dare you even right now to just lift up your arms and just to say, Jesus, I love you and I welcome your presence into my life. Come on, don't stop. Just keep them up. Thank you, Father, for your presence that's promised in our praise. You have to understand, church, the pit is what qualified Joseph for the palace. Without the crucifixion, there is no resurrection. God is stirring something. God is moving something around. And sometimes we can't see him because we're so masked
by the pain and the frustration, which I'm not belittling. This happened a year and a half ago, and I'm still blubbering like it happened yesterday. It hurts. It's paralyzing. It's crippling. But I believe there's a hope in Jesus that through this experience that you'll be able to tap into and ultimately unlock for whatever it's not over moment you're walking through. Do you believe it? Why is it as people we want everything easy? The EMTs informed my wife and I that there was less than a 1% chance survival rate of Josiah's type of injury. We were facing our toughest struggle in life. Josiah had broken his C3, 4, 5, and 6, and the paramedics said the fire department had a saying, once you break your C4, you are no more. Any bone broken above the C4 clavicle has very slim odds. Anybody that has the C4 and above has very slim odds of living, much less a normal life. Facing it's not over moments will certainly throw you into the workout room of struggle. Somebody say struggle. Listen to me. There's a graduation that occurs at the end of struggle that can catapult you into your next season if you allow it. However, you must allow yourself to be surrendered. Say surrender. Surrender to the struggle in order to step into the next session or the next season of your life. The journey of struggle involves release. You've got to release yourself into this thing called struggle. You have to allow God to work something out in the midst of your struggle. We come to church, we talk about excellence, we talk about living on the mountaintop, we talk about the victory of God, yet we go home and believe the report of CNN and Fox News on Monday. You know, we all sing, even as worshipers, even those in the parking lot ministry, those who are even here for the first time, we all sing that song, that great hymn every Sunday. I surrender half. Y'all know that song. I surrender half. All to thee, my part-time Savior. I surrender half. I like that. Half. And we blame other people. We blame the devil for stuff that we done did ourselves. We've been sowing into a lifestyle, and we're all surprised and blame the devil when we reap this life. Why doesn't nobody like me, God? Nobody like, because you're a grumpy old person. That's why nobody likes you. If you'd be nice every once in a while, maybe somebody would like you. Oh, it's just the devil. The devil's just trying to get me. It ain't the devil. It's your frown. Can I just drop this as a worship leader into you what I dropped into worship teams all over the world? If you have the joy of the Lord, do you have the joy of the Lord? Do you have the joy of the Lord? Listen to me. If you have the joy of the Lord, then notify your face. It'd be funny if it wasn't true. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great. And that's just the sopranos, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, what's going on here? But everything that happens to us, always the devil. It's that ugly devil. You know, I think part of it might be, but I think the other part is you. And the other part is me. Allowing the devil the access to do what he does. Because we've got the victory over him. Well, we got the victory, then why is the devil messing with you? Why are you allowing the devil into your home? I don't allow people in my home that are ugly to me. I don't allow people in my home that want to hurt me. I don't know. You know what we don't say in our home? Shut up. Sorry if I said it. Sorry, boys, if you heard that. We don't say that word. And a neighbor came over. One of the neighbor's boys who happened to be a preacher's kid. Just happened to be. I'm just going to be honest. He's, oh, just shut up. I won't say the boy's name, but let's just say his name's Abraham. I say, yo, Abraham. Yo, yo, yo. Hey, hey. We don't say that word. What word, Pastor Ricardo? We don't say that shut up word. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, okay. Like 2 seconds later, hey, shut up, y'all. I'm like, yo, Abraham. Come here. Now you got to get out of the pool. Come here. All right, bro. You say that again, you're not coming back for 3 days. Okay? 3 days. No swimming. All right. 2 seconds. Oh, y'all, shut up. And he turns, he looks at me. You know what I mean, guys. And my boys, they're junior highers now. They're starting to get into junior high. They're preteens. Pray for my wife and I. Everybody says, Ricardo, are you going to have a girl? And when I told mom that, you know, we were going to try for a girl, she said, son, I'm just going to tell you, with boys, you pay early. With girls, you pay the rest of your life. And all the men said, hey, ha, ho, help me, Jesus. I won't put you out there. I won't put you out there. But we allow people into our homes that want to bless us or that we want to bless. And even in this situation with Josiah, we wouldn't allow, once we got our feet underneath us, once we realized that we're going to get from the why to the what's next, we didn't want people around us who were speaking fear. We didn't want people around us who were saying he's going to be crippled the rest of his life. We stood up to those doctors and said, no, he ain't. He's going to live. My son's going to live in the name of Jesus. I refuse to let fear and doubt even come into my head. Listen, I'm going to allow the doctor to fill out his report, but I know there's a greater report that God's already written for my son's life in the name of Jesus, and that's the one I'm going to choose to believe. You're walking through, and it's not over season. There was this woman who came into Josiah's hospital room in urgent or emergency in the trauma unit where he was, and she was evil. Just Darth Vader, man, you know what I'm saying? Because she came and Josiah was minutes, probably 30 minutes, 35 minutes out from surgery, and the morphine was wearing off, and she adjusted his bed to give him medication, and my little 9-year-old baby laid out a groan that I'll never forget. Only a grown man should cry like that. A grown man who's experienced life and pain. A little 9-year-old child should not have to groan like that. And my beautiful little wife turned into a pit bull, I'm going to tell you right now. Josiah started groaning. Baby, I'm not calling you a dog if we're recording this, by the way. And it was almost like the nurse saw what we were thinking and heard what we were thinking. And she said, Mr. Sanchez, Mrs. Sanchez, please understand. The sooner your son sits up, the sooner he fights through this pain, the sooner the healing process will begin. There's a strength that comes from your fighting, church. There's a strength that comes from your struggle. There's a strength that comes. Only muscles are developed. There's certain muscles that can only be developed in this. It's not over season. And that's what God's doing. How do you move from the why through worship? You have to get from the why to the what's next. God, how can I use this circumstance? How can I use what I'm walking through today to glorify your kingdom and expand it from the north, the south, the east, and the west? How can I use it for your glory, God? The last thing I want to share with you is when Josiah had his brace off. A few weeks, I went up to his room to say his prayers. When we're in town, I go upstairs and say the boys' prayers by tickling their back. They roll on their bellies ever since they were infants. Because it's like they're hugging somebody, you know, and we pat their bottoms and tickle their backs. And I remember I walked up to Josiah and Micah's room. They share a room, and Ricardo, our oldest son, has his own room. And I woke up, and Micah's asleep, and Josiah, I mean, he was crying, yo. He was crying. And I'm like, baby, and I sit on his bed, and I look at him. I say, son, what's the matter? And Josiah looks at me with tears in his face, and he says, Daddy, I almost died. And I got so upset because the way that I saw it was the spirit of death was tormenting him. I almost had you. I'm going to find you. I'm going to get you. I'm coming after you and your family. I got so mad.
I didn't want to speak anything. What came out of my mouth was, baby, turn on your belly. I'm going to tickle your back. So he turns, and I start rubbing his back, and Josiah is so radically healed from God. Please understand. You would never know out of my three sons which one is Josiah, because he's so, the only way you would know is if he's wearing a t-shirt, and he would turn around, and from his hairline to his collar of his t-shirt, you would see the zipper where they put 24 staples in the back of his neck to close his head up. And as I'm praying for him, my hand hits this scar. And immediately God spoke to me. And this is what I want to speak to you. I said, Josiah, God just spoke to me. Son, your scar with your family, with your marriage, with your finances, with your relationships, with the health in your body, your scar does not remind me of death. Josiah, your scar reminds me of life. Your scar reminds me of God's mercy and God's grace and his long suffering and his patience and his power and his love over your life. This morning, you'll still beat the Baptist to the buffet. Don't worry about it. But I believe that God is stirring something here. Wherever we've been going and preaching this message, we're getting testimonies from people being delivered, marriages being restored, bodies being healed. Just go to our Facebook page. You'll see it, at Ricardo Music. This morning, if you're walking through and it's not overseas and in your life, you might not have a broken neck, but you might have a broken heart. I'm not going to be long, but I think it's worth the time that we're going to spend in prayer over you. You're walking through and it's not over season or moment in your life. I don't want you to think about it. I just want you to get out of the pew and run to this altar. Just get out of the place where you're sitting and come to this altar right now in the name of Jesus. You're walking through and it's not over season or moment. Could be your marriage. It could be your finances. It could be the health in your body. Don't even think of it. Just come forward. That's it. Thank you, Jesus. Look at this. Jesus. You need God to move. You're not going to stop until heaven shakes and a miracle falls out of it. We're going to wait for you. Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, those of you who are sitting down, you know somebody. Could be a family member. It could be a friend. Could be a coworker. You know somebody who's going through an it's not over moment. And they're not here today. And you want to see God activated in their life. Get out of your seat and come represent them at this altar. I believe God is going to do something. When God is in, there is no limit. When God is in,
it's not over, it's not over.
Sing and say.
When God is in it, there is no limit. When God is in it,
it's not over.
lift your hands real high. Father, before Pastor prays, I bless this congregation. I bless those this morning who had stepped out in faith, Father. Those who stepped out in trust, somebody say trust. Belief, somebody say belief. Somebody say reliance. Father, those that stepped out in trust, belief, and reliance, which defines faith. I believe it's activated the heavens in the name of Jesus, and whether it's physical, mental, spiritual, whatever it is that they're walking through, I thank you that your arm and your hand is strong enough, that your arm and your hand is long enough in the name of Jesus. And Father, sometimes the long way isn't always the wrong way.
That's good.
We just got more time to cook. The miracle has more time to be activated in the name of Jesus. The long way ain't always the wrong way.
Hallelujah.
So, Father, I bless them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet, that what they would touch would prosper to glorify your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And I thank you, Father, when God is in it, there is no limit. When God is in it, it's not over. Somebody shout to God. Hallelujah.
When God is in it, there is no limit.
When God is in
it, it's not over. It's not over. When God is in it, there is no limit. When God is in it, it's not over. It's not over.
When hallelujah. Now, how many of you know that God is in it? You know, Ricardo shared something really important that you need to understand. Earlier, I hope you caught it earlier. He said, the devil isn't playing with you. The devil isn't interested in dangling you around. He wants to kill you. I want you to understand, the fact that you're even standing up here today is evidence to the fact that God is still in it. Because if the devil had his way, you wouldn't even be here. So you need to take confidence and courage in the fact that God's in your stuff. God's in your situation. God's working. And do not take a lack of activity from your eyesight as a departure of God's presence from your life. Just because you don't see it doesn't mean it ain't happening. It's happening, okay? If your eyes could be open in the spirit, you would be seeing things unbelievably happening. Just like he said about the dream that that woman and her child had about Josiah when he dove in the pool. They had a dream. Those angels were under there. Come on, somebody. You've been having angels assist you and you didn't even know it. You've had angels protecting you, assigned to you, and you didn't even realize it. I'm here to tell you, God's still in it. God's still in it. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. So with hands raised up right now, I want you to give, in the middle of your pain and in the middle of your struggle, I want you to give thanks to God that you're still alive, that he's still working. And I especially want you to give thanks to God that it's not over. Don't let the devil tell you it's done, it's finished, the final words have been written, the book is closed. No, 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 no. God has the second edition and the third edition coming. God has the rest of the story to write in your life. Just begin to thank God right now. It's not over. It's not over. By any stretch of the imagination, it's not over. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. Hear me, too. Listen, listen. You know, the other thing that hit me, too, Ricardo, is what the EMT said. They didn't say he's 99% gone.
That's good.
He has a 1% chance.
When I read the Bible, I read that God created the heavens and the earth out of nothing. He didn't even need a 1%. But you give God a 1%, and I'm here to tell you, let me put another spin on it's not over. You give God a 1%, it's over. He's going to take care of business. He's going to take care of your business. God can do anything. God can do anything. God can do anything. Don't you despair. God can turn it around. He can do anything. Oh, yes. Woo, all right. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. I think you got it today. Amen. I want you to go back to your seats. Don't anybody leave. I'm going to have you do one last thing. It's very important that we do. Can you go back to your seats for just a minute? Haven't you enjoyed today and what God has done? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now listen, before you leave today, I'm going to give you an opportunity to sow into Ricardo's ministry, okay? How many of you have received from this ministry today? Amen? Come on, give the Lord thanks. That's good. And you clapped a little too long for the musicians today, I think. You don't get good talent like that for nothing. Those guys are blessed of the Lord, gifted of God. Amen. I firmly believe that when you have been imparted to, that you need to give back. And I just want you to know that Ricardo has come here this weekend. Yesterday, he was here all day for the concert of prayer. 9 o'clock service today, 11 o'clock service. No demands. He's made absolutely zero demands on us. They've been such a great team to work with. It's just been really good. And so there's not a set amount that we're supposed to give them today. They've just come in and just by faith, you know, whatever comes in the offering. Today, I want to encourage you to give liberally, to give abundantly. And I'm telling you that because this ministry is good soil to sow into, okay? They have blessed us, and now we want to bless them. Isn't that the right thing to do? So I want to encourage you in just a second, get out your checkbooks or cash. And you know, my daughter Ashley, come here. You felt like you should say something. I want you to do that related to what we're doing right now.
Yeah, I just felt during the first service toward the end, and I couldn't get away from it. So I said, Lord, if I'm supposed to say it, then don't let me get away from it. And he didn't. And you know that we don't hound, and when I say we, because we're family, Pastor does not hound us about giving. He doesn't do that. Even when we're blessed to have groups such as Ricardo and his team. But I really felt like God was maybe putting on someone's heart something to give, or he was impressing upon you something that you should do or give. And we don't believe at all that you need to pay monetarily for your blessing or your healing or your breakthrough. I don't believe in that. We don't believe in that. But it was what I felt like is, and we've heard Pastor Mike say, whatever he says to you, meaning God, whatever God says to you, do it. So if you are sitting in here and God was impressing upon your heart to do something or to give something, whatever he said to you, do it. And that your obedience in that was tied to your breakthrough, or it was tied to your healing, or it was tied to whatever it is that you're needing God to do, along with your worship, but we know that giving is an act of worship, which is why we bring our tithes and offerings up to the front as an act of worship. So whatever he says to you, do it. Don't leave and walk out of here in disobedience. Your breakthrough, your healing, whatever it is that you need could be tied to your obedience. So I just wanted to leave that.
Man, that's good. That's a good word. It's all about being obedient, isn't it? So listen, I'm going to pray over you. I want you to give today liberally. You're always so good to do that as a congregation. If you're making out checks, make it out to Life Source, and we will collectively put that in the offering, and we will give it to Ricardo. When you come to give, do not put it in our regular offering containers. That was for earlier in their tithes and offerings. Paul has the Marine on the front row, has already put out the plates for you. Where you see the gold plate, put it on there. When they fill up, just put it near there, okay? And we'll make sure that that goes for Ricardo and his team. Once again, have you appreciated that ministry today and what they brought to this house? Blessed be the Lord. Amen. Now listen, they have some product out in the lobby. We want you to get saturated with good praise and worship. How do I know it's good praise and worship? Because our team does a lot of it, okay? And it's good. And so you want to make sure that you take that with you. Whatever they've got out there, clear it out. We don't want them to have to send any product back home.
Tara, Pastor,
yo.
I am out of line, and if I am,
you are out
I'll
of line.
Get it later. Their new CD is awesome. It is anointed. It is powerful. We did a couple of things. The song that we did this morning, It's Not Over, it's on that CD. I encourage you to get it. You will be hearing their songs from the new CD in service. We'll be doing them. We are excited about it. But it is just power-packed. It is anointed. You've got to get it. Get it, get it, get it. It's awesome.
That's great. Thanks, Ashley. Amen. It's right from the horse's, I'm sorry, she's not a horse. It's right from the woman's mouth. That was good stuff there. Stand with me, please, all over this building. What a great day we've had in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to give you thanks because you've been so good to us, better than we deserve. Lord, we pray that what we have received today will not be stolen from us, but will be sealed by the Spirit of the living God. Lord, we go out of this place better than when we walked in the door, knowing that it's not over. That you're healing broken lives, broken marriages, broken health, broken finances. God, you're mending it. You're healing it all. And so, God, we give you thanks. Now, Lord, as we worship you in giving, this team has imparted to us. Now, we respond and impart back to them, and we sow seed. And I pray, God, your blessing upon Ricardo, his family, upon this team and their families. Keep them in your holy hands. God, while they're away from home and tending to your business, may you tend to their business. And God, bless them mightily. And I thank you for hearing and answering our prayer and blessing us as we leave this place today. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Let everybody say a good amen.
Amen.
Let's everybody say a really good amen.
Amen.
God bless you. I hope to see you tomorrow night at 7 o'clock for prayer in the house of the Lord. Come bring your offering. Go in the lobby and pick up their CDs. And may the Lord richly bless you.